Hi, good afternoon. Once again, good afternoon, students. Welcome back to the live webinar or live show. I'm sorry. Let me see how many of you are there. I'm sure you people have enjoyed the session which was there in the morning. We have a speaker from abroad. I'm sure you would have gone through the LinkedIn profile, Facebook profile of the speaker, which was shared to you people through the banner. We all are waiting for the speaker who is there in the background, green room, to come live. Once our audience strength will go up, we will call the speaker online. So requesting you people once again to talk to your students, invite them to come live. Unless we have very good strength, we cannot start the session. So we'll wait for another 5 minutes. Before that, I would like to hear from you. What is the expectation out of this webinar, which is going to start now? The induction program. Yeah, I could say good afternoon. Students, you can write back. You can write back in the chat box. What is your expectation from this induction program, this session of the induction program, which was named as Career Projects Prospects of Engineers? Somebody is thinking sportive thoughts. Okay. Any other answer? Good afternoon, Junaid. How are you? Good afternoon, Pasha. Mr. Pasha, good afternoon. Anirudh writes, get a better prospect on engineering career. A smart answer, I will tell. What you have done, smartly you have typed the topic. Very well. Well done. This is what is engineering. Smart work. Okay, Mr. Raghavendra is there. Okay. Junaid, I'm good. Thank you so much. Sumant is writing good facts about career. Yes, you'll be taken through. Sylvia ma'am will start her talk in few minutes. And personally, we know Sylvia ma'am is not a guest to EPCET. She is not at all a guest to EPCET. She is the family member. She keeps coming and she keeps motivating the students and the faculty fraternity of EPCET East Point. So we be live, stay tuned. She will be starting at any moment. Good afternoon, Harsha. How are you? Agastya Gowda, good afternoon. Harsha, good afternoon. Good afternoon. Let me hear from you. How was the show in the morning? How was the talk in the morning before we start the afternoon session? Okay. Great. Karthik is writing, it was very inspiring and motivating, sir. Thank you so much, Karthik. Karthi, what happens, this kind of compliments or comments or any suggestion and feedbacks keeps any institute growing, and it helps us to know how are the efforts going on. A lot of efforts are being put behind the screen. A lot of people are working for this, and we feel really happy when such comments do come, or anything else. If you have some certain suggestions and all, you are always welcome. You can speak to your faculties and all, and we can come back to you with the solution. Puneet is telling superb, great. Chandushri, happy to hear this kind of audience we have got. So I'm sure Sylvia ma'am will have a good time. You will respect the time and knowledge of Sylvia ma'am once she starts. Monica, inspiring, very good. Manikant, superb, wonderful. Anirudh is writing, the show was a real help. It should, how yoga and meditation help us, a student in our development. Wonderful. Great. Yes, Monish, I heard. How about you? Thank you, Rohit. Thank you, Varshita. Good afternoon. Okay, Impana, it was so interactive. It was not at all boring. So interaction is something which has to be two-way. We know personally the eminent speakers, whoever are coming, are eminent speaker. They are well-known speaker, not only in the country, but abroad as well. So interactive, if you want to be to have these sessions interactive, this comes back to you. You need to be interactive. You need to be agile. You need to write a lot of comments and all. Do ask queries and all, whichever comes to your mind. Do not hesitate writing that, but write it professionally. We will make sure the speakers would answer to all your queries. We will look into that. Thank you, Shweta. Superb, Anil. Oh, good. Vaishnavi, we are happy to hear that you got inspired. Nandini is telling, I understood positive mind makes positive life from morning session. So great. These are the takeaways we want our young engineers or young Indians to get inspired from. Our dear students will be on in 30 seconds. I can see our speaker is there and all the guests have already arrived in the green room. And we are going to start the session in another 30, 40 seconds. Right. So once again, let me take people on stream. Over to Yogesh, sir. Sir.
A very good afternoon, everyone. I heartily welcome all of you for this session on career prospects for engineers. Dear students, at the outset, it's my pleasure and honor to welcome our chief guest for the day, Dr. Silvia Liberto Ullo. And I also welcome our honorable principal, sir, Dr. Prakash S. East Point College of Engineering and Technology as a MOU with the University of Sanio, Italy. The main intention of MOU is to have exchange of knowledge between the two esteemed organizations. Under this collaboration, recently we conducted one international conference, which was a very huge success. In continuation, we are conducting this talk. Let me give a brief introduction to the guest. Silvia Liberto Ullo is a senior IEEE member and industry liaison for IEEE Italy, joint COMSAC and VTS chapter. She is a member of the Academic Senate at the University of Sanio and the national referent for FIDA PA. And she is a member of Academic Senate at the University of Sanio. BPW Italy Science and Technology Task Force, graduated with Laude in Electronics Engineering at the Faculty of Engineering of Federico University. She received the MS in Management from MIT, USA in June 1992. Since 2004, she is a researcher with University of San Diego de Benavento, where she teaches signal theory, telecommunication networks, courses for the degree in electronics engineer, and the optical and radar remote sensing as PhD course. She has authored 76 research papers in reputed journals and conferences, and co-authored many book chapters. Her research interests mainly deal with signal processing, remote sensing, image and satellite data analysis, machine learning applied to satellite data, radar systems, sensor networks, and smart grids. With this brief introduction, I heartily welcome Dr. Silvia Liberto. Heartily welcome you, madam.
Hi, good afternoon to you and good morning to me. Hi to everybody. Very happy to be with you again. It's always a big honor and a true happiness, a joy for me to stay with you and with your students. Students that I feel like my students in a certain sense. So, hi to everybody.
Thank you, thank you. Over to you, Prakash sir.
He's a mute. Is muted.
Sir, you are on mute, sir.
Yeah, good afternoon, dear students. It's a great privilege and honor to host Silvia ma'am today. It's a long-lasting relationship with Silvia madam. We are with our university. We have signed up an MOU with her university and one flagship international conference in association with the university we have done, and she was instrumental in having this relationship taking forward. She was keynote speaker for our international conference, which was actually published with Springer. It is, anytime we ask for any support, I think wholeheartedly she, overwhelmingly she comes and gives the support. Either it could be in terms of delivering a talk to our students, or it could be in terms of any research proposals what we are preparing and sending in association with the university. Madam, very kind of you. Thank you so much. I think it's a really honor, and we are privileged for you to host here. And over to you to listen to you, madam. I don't want to take much time here.
Thank you. You are very welcome.
Thank you, madam. Thank you. Yes, Yogesh?
Yes. Over to you, Silvia, madam. You can start.
Okay, so I will share my screen and I start with my presentation. But you know, before a lot of students were talking about the presentation which they attended in the morning, and they liked also the possibility to be, to you know, to have an interactive presentation. I ask them, okay, I have to present and to speak, but if they like to interrupt or to make questions, even during the presentation, is not so bad, because this is not a formal, you know, lesson that they cannot interrupt. So decide to be even free to ask questions during the presentation if you wish. Okay, so I go, I share the screen. Okay, this is the first slide, just you know to start, but you know that this is a live induction session for first year engineering students. I want just you know to say some words before starting. This presentation belongs to you know to the orientation activities that your university does to make you understand or to convince even more you how important is your choice to study engineering. But besides all the things that I will talk about later on, I want also to make you think about what I'm doing. I think that even this opportunity to stay with you, to interact with you, to stay in a part of the world so far away, I'm in Italy right now, it's a quarter to 10 in the morning, for you is afternoon instead. So even if we are far away in a different time, but when you study, when you do and I think above all technical studies, you can interact with other people in all the parts of the world, sharing your expertise, your studies, your research, your background, and so think also to this opportunity for you in the future. I think it's very important. Okay, so going ahead, as our principal was saying before, I attended as a speaker the conference, this conference, that was organized by the East Point College in collaboration with my university. University of Sannio is located in Benevento, in Italy, and is not a big university, but is very dynamic. We host a lot of students from all over the world, and I really hope to be able to create a program to host also students from your university to Italy, to our university, because we have a lot of students also from India, but from everywhere. Besides this, okay, this was the talk that I give. If you see is the title, just you know to share with you the things that I have done, the big data revolution and industry 4.0 and impact on operative fields and advanced tools for data collection and analysis. So this title shows something related to Internet of Things, big data and industry 4.0. And as I will explain later, this is just one part of the things that I study and that I do for my research. Just to underline how the way in which an engineer studies is always very, very broad usually. Now, so we become able to deal with a lot of different topics, not everything, otherwise, you know, it becomes strange, but inside our fields of expertise, we become able, you know, to deal with some topics of some related topics important for what we do. Besides that, this was another occasion in which I could collaborate with your university, was in December 2019, and I came to your wonderful place. Your university is very well organized, even outside. I could enjoy all, you know, all the areas and the way in which the place has been built. And I had this talk, this technical talk, on satellite remote sensing for monitoring our planet that is much closer to my research topics. I will try to give also some examples at the end of my today's presentation. It was a very honored and a pleasure for me. I like to show these pictures. I did this again in the conference, but you know, because with these pictures, it seems to me to be really there with you, even if I know that now everybody is working from home. But here I was in the office of dear Prakash, the principal, with my friend and colleague Yogesh, and Lin Lin, another colleague. Here is other, there are other pictures, the ceremony. And here we visit the memorial of Dr. Venkatapati, who is the founder of your college. I put this slide, but you know this, because you know everything, I hope, of your college. But for me, it's always amazing, you know, to remember to myself that this college was established under the aegis of the Charitable Trust, founded by the educational visionary Dr. Venkatapati, in 1999. So your university has almost the same age of my university. And this college, after 19 years, actually a little bit more now, is a feeder in the cap of the trust, which is running a dozen educational institutes in its various campuses, such as, I don't know how to pronounce, but I try to say Jana Prabha, and HSR layout in Bangalore, and the international school in Dubai. So the vision is to establish institutions and centers of excellence to impart professional education in a learner-centric environment. I think that, you know, this vision, I could feel that this vision is alive, is something that everybody, your professors and the principal and all the people working in the organization of your institution do, so they really believe to make you part of the center of, you know, of an environment in contact with all the world. And I am, you know, an example, one of the examples. I'm very happy to take part in this lecture on career prospects in engineering because I have been I did orientation activities for my universities for almost 10 years, and I'm very honored to be able to do it even for the East Point College, for your university. And as I said before, I feel you like my students. And on the bottom of this slide, I will share this presentation. I will send this presentation. You can find my email on the right. And also, you know, my the link of Google Scholar, if you want just to look at the main articles that I published, also to see which kind of research perhaps we can carry on together. This was already, you know, said by Yogesh, but just some, I like to repeat just some points to make you see how different was my background, because I graduated in electronic engineering and I chose telecommunication as my major degree. My specialization was in telecommunications, and I graduated, it was, you know, the full graduation, the 5 years at that time, and I was 24 years old. I won a scholarship, and in a few months I left Italy and I went to USA to take the master of science in management at the Massachusetts Institute of Technology, where I graduated in 1992. When I came back to Italy, I decided to work for the company, this Italtel, telecommunication company, who issued the scholarship. The scholarship which allowed me to go to USA to take the master. I was not obliged to do this, but I felt, you know, to thank, in a certain sense, this company. And so I worked for this company for almost 10 years. The work in a company is completely different from you know, a university. We did some research, but it's a very applied research. And also I managed the production lines. I had to supervise the workers. So it was a completely different work. Then I decided to come back to my city, that is Benevento, because Italtel was in another city. And so I applied for a public competition. I won this public competition and I went to work for the municipality of Benevento, so a public company. So I moved from a private company to a public company. And in this municipality, I worked in the data processing center for 4 years. After that, I decided to change again, and every time was my decision. So it was not, you know, a situation in which I was fired off and I had to change. No, I decided to quit my job and to start with another one. And in 2014, so after a long period since I graduated, that was 1989, I started doing research in the engineering department of the University of Sannio in Benevento, even if it was not the university where I graduated, because I graduated in Naples. When I graduated in 1989, the university in Benevento was not there. Now I teach some classes, as you can see, basic math, telecommunication networks, theory and signal processing, a course for PhD students, optical and radar remote sensing, and the main topics of research are satellite data analysis for Earth observation, radar systems, sensor networks, with application to environmental monitoring. Just, you know, to make you see how different, you know, were the things that I did during my job life, let's say. What is the work world looking for nowadays? People able to carry on specific activities and doing them right. Seems something very, very obvious, but if we look around us, all of us want the same. When we need something, we want that our mobile phone, for instance, works, that our computer is connected to internet and works well. We want to send the messages quickly when we need to transfer files or information and receive them quickly as well. We like to imagine cars moving in the future without the need to drive them. And we have a lot of wishes in our mind, and perhaps all these wishes will be shaped soon. But what we want is that everything works correctly. So imagine the same happens to the other. If someone is looking for for someone to hire, looks for this person able to do things well, correctly, without mistakes or without few mistakes, without too many mistakes, with just a few mistakes, and able to demonstrate a big ability. to deal with many things in a broad way, with some things in a very detailed way, but all these things must or should be done in a right, in a correct way. Becoming skilled people is therefore fundamental to become attractive, you know, to become in a such a way that the other one is looking to us and say, ah, okay, I want that person, I want to hire that person, I want to collaborate with that person. Obviously, is not sufficient this. Some of you said that this morning you had a meditation class. I think it was very good. So really congratulations, compliments to the organizer, because, you know, to put technical things with also something like a meditation course, I think is very important, because you know, we can reach our goals if our body is healthy, but also if our mind is healthy. And sometimes not everybody thinks that, you know, mind and body are not two separated things, but they need to collaborate, even, you know, in us, in ourselves. So again, become skilled people is important to become attractive, but we need to find the motivation inside us. And I always say to the students, when I go to the high school, when I went to the high school, that becoming an engineer is the best thing in the world. You know, I always believe this. I know that maybe can seems too much, but in all the professional figures, all the professional people, I find that the engineer is the one able to do a lot of things. An engineer solves problems, and I can say that solves problems, almost all the problems, and correctly. An engineer learns how to transform ideas in practice, in real things. An engineer knows the basic principles of many matters. An engineer is able to dealing with high-level problems. And also, it's a lot of fun. Maybe now that you are studying, you are thinking that I'm crazy, because you study a lot and you think that there is not fun on that. Instead, I invite you, even in your study and then in your job in the future, to find the fun part of that. Because in this way, think about this, it's not a joke. I'm serious saying this. If you are able to find the fun part, even in your study, it becomes something more enjoyable for you. And so you do this in, you know, in an easier way. So I said, you know, again, that becoming skilled people is fundamental to become attractive. And I want to underline that the demand for engineering and for engineers is increasing exponentially by the day. The scope for engineers is quite high in public sectors, but also in the private sector are preferring engineering graduate students as well, much more students from engineering than from other universities, other, you know, courses. And also remember another things, to be a successful engineer, one has to be constantly updated with the emerging trends and technologies, because learning is a lifelong process. You don't need to worry about this. But I want just to say that since technologies changes, and even you know, in a lot of fields there are new discoveries, is important if you want to continue to remain, to become attractive, you need to update yourself, your knowledge. Okay, obviously it's a choice. You can even decide to stay as you are, but the best thing is to take you always updated with the last trends and technologies. In your case, you have already chosen engineering. This slide was, for people that had still to decide. But so I go ahead in this way to make you happy with your choice. Why to choose engineering and which type of engineering? All the engineerings are connected and are very important in a multidisciplinary vision of research and study. I don't know now which type of engineering you have chosen, but as I will show in these slides, we can, I based these slides on my university. We have civil engineering, electronic engineering, computer science engineering, and energy engineering. And so I replied the same sequence of slides. But you have to think, but I'm sure that you know already, that all these engineerings are linked among them. So when we speak, for instance, on civil engineering, you know that you deal with structures, buildings, let's say, with infrastructures. So roads and water channels and so on, or urban planning. So it's necessary to do calculation, drawing, or even dealing with important things related to the design in seismic areas. So the right design for a risky region. Or other things like construction recovery and maintenance. So civil engineering deals with a lot of applications and aspects of our life, but all these things needs, for instance, particular softwares. All these things need devices, specific elements that a civil engineer needs to know besides all the study. So there is some interaction with other type of engineerings. This is energy engineering that deals with the primary energy resources like fossil, nuclear, biomasses, solar, wind, water, geothermal. And the energy engineering is very fascinating, I think, even if I didn't study that, because it helps us understand how important is to study these issues. To defend our planet. We always hears talking about climate change and all the consequences, the bad consequences. Think to the permafrost blending and other issues. So the energy engineering prepares students to learn and to study a lot of topics that will help our planet to find a new way to produce energy and to solve a lot of related problems. And I skip this because it's too particular, too technical. Computer science engineering also deals with very fascinating challenges. Here there are just some examples, like the automation in the car, in the house, or games, or app on your smartphone. And here on the bottom of this slide is a competition that was run, and the computer won against two people. The computer science engineering opens a lot of different journeys, let's say, to machine learning, artificial intelligence, and so on. But we know that the computer science engineering plays a significant role in other engineerings, because, you know, almost all the devices right now are based on software, so, and hardware also, but you know, the computer science is very important to for the other engineerings. Here are there is the electronics and telecommunications engineering. I put some more slides here, because this is, as you know, as I told before, this is my main, you know, major. I graduated in electronic engineering, and telecommunications was my specialization. But as you can see from this slide and the other ones, all these objects, from you know, the robotic hand to the devices to measure the signals, or the satellites, or the antenna, or the microchips, the components, all these things again are they can work because they are based also on a significant portion of software. Otherwise, they would not be able to work. These are other examples: fiber optics, augmented reality, drones, drones applied also for emergency, a smart home, and other things, antennas, and so on. Holograms here on the left. So the electronic and telecommunications telecommunication engineering is an application-oriented study program with application in robotics, to summarize, industrial automation, telecommunication system, biomedical instrumentation, consumer electronics, and sensors. So you have such a broad vision of possible fields of application in all the types of engineering. Here you can see other examples. For instance, we have laboratories to put the hands on and to move from theory to practice. I'm sure that the same is for your college. Obviously, in this moment, we are working, and our students are studying online since almost 1 year now. And so it's very difficult, it's quite difficult to work with this instrumentation, with this device. We use a particular application to interact with this device remotely, but obviously it's not the same, but we try, you know, to do something. Anyway, we can find, so in these labs, a way to carry on electronics measures for automation, measurements of electronic instruments, measurements for telecommunications, measurements of electromagnetic fields, and much more, and many other things. So this is like to summarize again how engineering, in particular electronics, deal with the micro and the nanotechnologies, sensor and self-diagnostic systems, integrated circuits, microcontrollers, DSP, information transmission system, and telecommunications with antenna, radar systems, satellite navigators, digital transmission systems, Bluetooth, audio and video signal processing. But, you know, all together we have to remember that the basic functioning is possible thanks to computer science, both hardware and software. I put this question thinking, you know, to the electronics and telecommunications engineers, and so I was asking to myself, but is, you know, is a way to talk to you. Are the electronics and telecommunications engineers required? We can answer that the request everywhere, so is a global prospective of career, are higher than graduated students. I read something, but you know, I always try to see the real request of electronics, computer science, and telecommunications engineers, and the request is higher than, you know, the offer of the number of graduated students. The main request is from companies in the automotive sector. Obviously, think that I did this research before the pandemic situation. Now maybe the situation might be a little bit different. Companies in the aerospace and space sector, electronic or IT consulting firms, communication service companies, research centers, as CERN. CERN, I think that you know, is a very big research center. NASA is the space center from USA, while ESA stands for European Space Agency, is the space agency for Europe. NASA and ESA right now collaborate a lot with respect to the past, so they do a lot of things together. And obviously another request after graduation of the engineers can be in the university. I have to say that the career in the universities is quite tough, but if your dream is to work there, you have to to follow what you like, not just thinking to how difficult it is, how much time, and so on. But the time to reach the top positions in the universities is quite long, I would say. Okay, so these are other examples of research projects. Some of these are research projects where I or my colleague work, and there are some examples of, for instance, the wearable sensors, vibration sensors for flexographic printing and underwater measurements, precision phase measurements, sensors for the control of the trucks and the railway network, smart health and fiber optics, and remote sensing and satellite remote sensing, and monitoring the environment. So all these applications can be done using the knowledge that I studied in the electronic and telecommunication engineering. I wanted to say one thing. Obviously, one course, no, one, you study 3 years, I think. I don't know, in Italy is 3 years plus two, in USA is 4 years plus two. But at the end of your study, even if you studied a lot, you did a lot of courses of different classes, you cannot study everything. Is impossible, even in the electronic engineering. In fact, there are some universities that have some courses and other universities that have the basic courses are the same, but specific, specialized courses are a little bit different. So it's impossible. What is important that you have to remember is that you become able to study everything. That means not only everything in engineering, but everything in also in other disciplines like economics and other things. So is your ability at the end of your study to become able to catch all the, you know, all the things to study, obviously. You know, you cannot invent, you cannot start from nothing, but you are able to take a book or to know how to do, to learn things that you couldn't, you know, you couldn't study during your university. And this is a strength that the engineer has. Going ahead with the other slides, obviously, since the topic was this presentation was for you, I tried to see if the electronics and telecommunications engineers are also required in India and how much. Behind electronics and telecommunications engineers read also computer science, all, you know, the things that are related to these courses. So the potential recruiters and sectors in India are both in the government and in the private sectors. And regard both this plethora of career opportunities regard all the engineers in the electronics and telecommunications or electronics and computer science engineering. Here are some of the important sectors and the recruiters for ETE or ECE students. Okay, so I found a small research. There is a link on the bottom of this slide, so you can even go there and see if there are updatings. And the main requests are from the government sector side, public sector units. In this case, the students need to clear GATE. There is a slide on this. The main organization are these listed here. So Indian Space Research Organization. So you see again the space. So it's not just in Italy or in Europe, but also the Indian Space Research Organization looks for engineers. The Electronics Corporation of India Limited, the Bhabha Atomic Research Center, sorry for my pronunciation, I don't know if it's Bhabha, the Defense Research and Development Organization, the Bharat Electronics Limited, Defense Electronics Research Laboratory, Bharat Heavy Electricals Limited, Hindustan Aeronautics Limited, and the railway departments. So railways was also one of the applications that we saw before in the previous slide. So this is the government sector side, and from the private sector side, I could find Intel Corporation, Samsung Electronics, Texas Instruments, Philips Semiconductors, the Hewlett-Packard, International Business Machine Corporation, Cisco Systems, HCL Technologies. And as you can see, in the private sector, there are many international companies. So this, you know, just to repeat and to highlight again that the type of career prospect for engineers is even global, obviously, if you want. I'm not saying that you have to go somewhere, but you know, the opportunities are in your country, but also in the private sector, in these companies. But since these companies are from most of them are American companies, you can be sure that your expertise will be considered valuable, important also abroad. I put this slide on GATE because I found that this graduate aptitude test in engineering is required also from the companies during the interview. So is I think that you know this was maybe was something new for me. Anyway, it's an examination which is conducted for Master of Engineering, Masters in Technology, and direct PhD admissions to Indian Institute of Technology, National Institute of Technology, Indian Institute of Information Technology, and other institute or university across India. It also opens the gateway to booming public sector organization, as we have seen before, in the field of research. Some of the of these public sector organizations and the research organizations which use GATE score for providing jobs include ONGC, NTPC, GAIL, and so on. So you see that there are, you know, a lot of organizations looking for this GATE, for this graduate aptitude test. Is an all-India examination administered and conducted in 8 zones across the country by the GATE committee, and more than 2,000 jobs are available at leading public sector organization in India. So to crack the interview, an aspirant must have sharp and deep technical skills and the knowledge of corresponding engineering courses. I put, you know, in bold this sentence because this, you know, let's go a little bit back to, you know, to the first line, to become attractive. So they look, an aspirant, you, me, no, you that are young, are the aspirants. You must have sharp and deep technical skill and knowledge of corresponding engineering courses. So your choice, the choice that you have done, is the right one. Now it's up to you, okay, to use these years to study the technical things in such a way that your knowledge becomes sharp and deep. Okay, so not just study, but study in such a way that your knowledge becomes sharp and deep. Sometimes I say to my students, okay, we need to study because we don't know something. We study an equation. We need to study a theoretical part of something. So it's a kind of a passive action because, you know, we have in our mind like a white paper. And we need, you know, to absorb what has been done by others, no? So physicians or even scientists in the past. But sometimes after studying, we need to turn on our mind and to move from a passive to an active action. So we have to think to what we have studied. And to see if there are other ways, you know, to do the same things. Why not? Maybe you will become able to find different solutions to problems that everybody has done always in the same way. But if you turn on your mind and you move from the passive to the active action, you will become able, I'm sure, to find different solutions, you know, to the same problems. Anyway, so in okay, sorry for this. I put a slide for the BMS Institute. So I apologize with the East Point College because I forgot to change this slide. But also, you know, your college is obviously very important and prepares you to face this test as well as other important tests in India. Again, these are the main companies hiring in India based on GATE. And these are the top four, there are 40 leading companies. There is the link on the bottom of this slide, recruiting students based on the GATE score. And I put just the first 13 that move from Indian Oil to BSNL, to Delhi Development Authority, to the Maharashtra State Electricity Transmission Company, Nuclear Power Corporation of India Limited, Oil and Natural Gas Corporation, Power System Operation Corporation, Power Grid Corporation of India Limited, Punjab State Power Corporation, Punjab State Transmission Corporation Limited, West Bengal State Electricity Distribution Company, Defense Research and Development Organization, Hindustan Petroleum Corporation. And there are many, many others. Okay, the list goes ahead. Anyway, so you are on the right, so you are going to, you know, to climb the ladder and to become more and more expert in the things that you study. Okay. Before going ahead, because, you know, now these slides are more technical, explaining some particular topics like embedded systems and other things, I'd like to know if we want to take a small break and take some questions, or just brainstorming, just to discuss. What do you think? I ask to... No, to the organizer or even to the students. What do you think?
Yes, ma'am, we can have some question and answer session. I'll just put up on the...
Yeah, a big kiss to your kids. I love them. If the students want to put some questions or just to talk about, you know, their ideas, their prospect. Silvia, ma'am, that's me, will be happy to answer you. I don't know, dear students, you are so shy that you don't want to talk and to ask anything or to say your opinion about something. Yeah? No? You want just to hear what I'm saying? As you wish. If you don't want, I just go ahead. You know, I just I have the sensation that just talking is quite boring for you. But if you don't want to ask question, I go ahead, as you prefer. Before, I found interesting a student that put a question about sports. Mom, that's me, mom, how to overcome failure? Good question. When you say, when you write, thank you, A.J. Rakshit, I hope to pronounce well your name, failure, you mean when you don't pass an exam, or failure in your life, a general failure? I imagine this, that since you are talking about, you know, you are students, I imagine that you are talking about an exam. But, you know, this is not a very important failure, because that failure, even if, you know, makes you suffering a lot, I imagine, depends most of you. So you have just to understand why Okay, why didn't you pass an exam? Why you didn't pass the exam? So the important things, but if you are shy, I mean, it's very difficult, is to interact with the professor or with the assistants to understand what was wrong, if you did the test or if you didn't pass the oral part. But if you think about this depends mostly on you, on how well you studied, on how well you interact with your professor or assistant. And so you can easily, I think, be able to understand the parts to improve, even interacting and asking to your colleagues, to the other students, not how to overcome the failures of life. I think is much more complex, much more suffering, but even the study of the studies in engineering can make you stronger to face all the possible failures that normally happen. So you have just to understand. I say always that, we are engineers. So the engineers don't see failures or don't see problems. They look for solutions. So when you see a problem or a failure, you try to design, the project, the right project, to find the solution. I hope to have answered to your questions. Mom, I lost the other question. Thank you. You're welcome. There was another question because how to get a job in NASA or SpaceX? SpaceX, I know that you know that because it's a private company. We could read in all the newspapers and the magazine about this person, very rich, who is spending a lot of money. I would say to look in internet for job application, even for NASA, is not so difficult as you think. The ESA, European Space Agency, also have a lot of job applications. But ESA, European Space Agency, is more related, unfortunately, to European. Instead, I think that NASA and the SpaceX are open to everybody. So I don't know exactly how to get a job, but if you really like to do this, start now, because you are very young and you are at the beginning of your university career. Try to read which kind of position are available and try even to shape your studies in such a way to become attractive to them. And I'm sure that you will be able to do this. Find an email, write to them, and try to, to start thinking how to change what to study to become attractive to these companies. What criteria you let in students on undergraduate and postgraduate program? You let in? Can you, dear Siva, can you explain differently the question? Cioè, the criteria? You mean in our university? To come in our university, the criteria for the students?
Yes, yes, ma'am. Probably your university, he means to say.
Yeah, I mean, in Italy, the university can be a student has to finish the high school. The high school in Italy lasts 5 years. But for foreigner students, maybe it's possible, I'm sure that it's possible to apply. There are a lot of universities, also my university, which host students from other parts of the world. And I don't think that there are particular criteria. You need to pass the test. Okay, so there are specific tests for engineering to apply, but they are not very, very tough. There is a test for incoming students, and this test is for everybody, so Italian or not Italian students. It's called TOLC, T-O-L-C, and so to come in the engineering university, you have to take this test. Talk, but you have to have done the high school. The PhD programs, we have PhD students from outside, so from all over the world, and the PhD students must have finished the full program, so bachelor plus master, to apply to university in Italy for the PhD student. What is the best way to prepare for masters in abroad from now? Okay, if you want to come to a specific country, if it's an English speaking country, USA or England, you know English for sure better than me, so it's much easier for you, because if you have a very good preparation, no, background from the bachelor course, I'm sure that you can apply, but obviously careful that every country has different rules. Now, I know that, for instance, in USA, there must be specific test to apply English and also technical test. I can talk about Italy. And in our case, we have some master programs that are in English. So you, in that case, you need just to take the test to come in. If you choose a particular university in which even the master courses are in Italian, you have to take a small class of Italian. And there are students that do this. Some students go to, I don't remember now, I think it's in Florence. There is a university which takes short classes of Italian for international students to make them able to start university programs in engineering, in economics, in other things, where the university do not take the classes in English. You know, besides, you know, I can see in your questions, and thank you for the questions, that obviously you look to the future, but is not, you know, the future like in 20 years. Is the future in 3 years, let's say, or even four, or maybe five, but is, let's say, is a short run, okay, short middle run. What is important is to go to the end of the process. Like if you had to apply now, you go and look at the websites, look for all the information, like if you were to apply in this moment. Find which are the conditions. In this moment, you start building all the things that are important to reach those goals. If for you is important, because in this moment you have all the time to do that, so it's the best in a way. Thanks to you, Hamza Aishu. I hope that my pronunciation is correct. Okay. I will share my presentation. I will send my presentation to Shilpa so she can I will correct the slide that is wrong, obviously. Tell me, do you want that? How much time do I have until the end?
You can continue, ma'am. No issues.
But how much time? Just, you know, to know.
Maybe another 15 minutes, ma'am.
15?
15
okay,
to 20
so,
minutes.
You know, I try to skip some slides and to... Okay, thank you. So I need to share again the screen.
Yes, ma'am.
Okay, these are the, you know, all these slides were to, you know, to make you be sure that what you are studying is important for a lot of possible applications. Obviously, at the first year, you study basic matters like maths, physics, maybe chemistry, I don't know, but you know, you don't feel that your study is practical. You see it, your courses just as theoretical courses, but even the basic classes are important. But in the next years, you will find other courses that will make you more able to understand all the possible application of electronics and communication engineering. In this example, I try, you know, to put something on embedded systems that are one of the leading specializations in the field of electronics and communications. And these systems are a combination of hardware and software that are dedicated for a specific function. These systems are programmed systems in which software is usually embedded into the hardware to perform particular tasks. As you see, again, the software, the computer science, is inside. Okay, so it's always part of this. Also, to tell you that in your study, when you face with the new programs to study, I don't know if you study Python or MATLAB or whatever. I remember in my case that I didn't like so much to study, you know, the softwares, but I suggest you to find the fun part of them so you can study this software, because it's very important. They are part they are embedded, you know, in a lot of systems, even if you study electronics and communications or electronics engineering. Here are some examples. For instance, the very large scale integration is one of the topic, and the principle behind the electronics in this case are speed, compactness, affordability. No, but these slides are very technical. So just, you know, to make you see how many things are part of the electronics and communications study. These are other examples. Digital image processing is another discipline that deals with the processing of digital images with the help of computer. Again, you see computer algorithms. Consequently, this branch has many advantages. A major merit is the improvement of a pictorial representation in terms of signal noise and signal distortion. I mean, there is no time to go such in detail, but here, you know, you see the study and this digital image processing must be done in such a way that the process is the best possible process. So what does it mean? That you know, it must reduce disturbances that in this case can be signal noise, signal distortions. So you learn not just something, but how to do this fix in a good way, almost without mistakes, like I was saying at the beginning. Other example, analog and digital electronics. Even here, there are other examples. I think that I need to go a little bit faster here. So robotics, Internet of Things, that, you know, we are hearing every day talking about this technology, very related to, you know, to internet and arising the issue of big data, wireless communication, that make the wireless communications make not only our mobile phones work, for instance, but also everything that is not connected with a wire. So imagine to the Wi-Fi of our computer, but also to the satellite communication, microwave, radio communications. Since my sector of research is the satellite remote sensing, I try to focus a little bit some slides on that. I don't know how much do you know about remote sensing, but you know, it's a way to monitor our surface or an object of interest without stay in contact, in physical contact with this object. Satellite remote sensing has mainly the goal to monitor our planet and to understand the changes and also the health of our planet. I look for the someone before was asking about NASA, about other space company, but you have also remember that you have an Indian space company, you have an Indian space research organization, and the India has also remote sensing satellites. So India launched, you can see here, the past satellites from 1975, these are the names and the dates. So India launched many satellites from 1975 up to here, the slides, the most recent are 2003, 2005, 2007, 2018. But, you know, I'm sure that if you and me, if we look for other satellites, we can find even more. So you can imagine that your country plays an important role in the space, because consider that the position in the space is very important. How to explain? Even the space has become, and not now, as you've seen, no, it's like 30 years, more, 40, 50 years, has become a ground of conquest. Okay, so it's important to have a position, to have satellites there, because all the countries have understood that in such a way, in this way, so having their own satellites, they can monitor the planet. Okay, yes, the main goals are to see the changes, if the planet is healthy or not, but from the satellites, it's possible to see a lot of things. Okay, so it's also, you know, a way to control other countries. Maybe I shouldn't say this, but let's say this is not the, you know, the most important part. But if the countries have their own satellites, they can do a lot of things. So it's very important. This is a way to show you what is remote sensing from the satellite point of view. And this is what I'm working on. I have some collaboration with the ESA, with the European Space Agency. Some students during their thesis, or even some PhD students of mine, go close to Roma. There are the headquarters in Italy for ESA. I like this video because it's very nice. It shows how to, you know, what ESA does. So I hope that it starts.
Welcome to the first ESA MOOC on Earth observation from space. We are really excited you are on board with us for this journey.
Earth orbiting satellites are completely revolutionizing the picture we've got of our home planet. They're showing not only its great beauty, but also its complexity. We've seen from the vantage point of Voyager 1 in the outer reaches of the solar system, how small and vulnerable is our planet in the dark blackness of space. Satellites around the Earth, however, are giving us the fine detail that we need to understand the big problems and challenges we face in climate change and environmental change. And the rapid advances in technology are now giving us a much more powerful and comprehensive set of measurements than we've ever had in the past.
We are in the midst of a data revolution. With the launch of the Sentinel data, we'll get sustained observation for the next decade. And this observation will be really important to better understand our planet, understand processes, but also support decision-making related to climate change and monitoring of the environment.
The intention of this course is to excite you about Earth observation, its power and its value. It will set out the fundamental principles by which we make measurements from space. It will tell you about how those measurements are used. It will show you the kind of problems that Earth observation can be fundamental to solving. And most of all, it intends to be inspiring and informative.
I hope it will be a great opportunity for you to discover the value of Earth observation, how we can use it in science, but also to support decisions related to climate change. We want to expose you to the beauty of the data, why it's fascinating. You will learn about how to use the data in context with other data, how to process them, and how to make the most of it. And we hope this course will bring you a new perspective on this technology. So looking forward to working with you in the next few months and better understand how to make the most of these data.
So I'm sure that you found amazing this video. This video was realized by ESA for some courses that they take, to teach Earth observation, remote sensing. Obviously, engineering and electronic and telecommunications engineering or computer science is not just satellite remote sensing. I show you before a lot of different applications in civil energy engineering and other examples. So this is just one possible future job, let's say. Is not the only one, obviously, but you know, is the main things in which I do also my research. I collaborate with Pierre-Philippe Mathieu, is one of the first persons who talked, and so I like a lot this video. And as regards this, I want just to show you some slides to explain a project that I did. If you see on the bottom, this project was carried on with ESA, my university, and MIT. And this project that was done last January, but we are starting with another group working again on similar topics, was on artificial intelligence for Earth observation to quantify socioeconomic development from space. So the idea is to identify some environmental variables, some essential environmental variables, to monitor from the space and to provide the basis to quantify the socioeconomic indicators, helping society to better navigate towards the sustainable development. It's a project in progress in collaboration, as I told you, with ESA and MIT. And what is the idea? That space technologies have been contributing to the United Nations Sustainable Development Goals for decades, including satellite Earth observation, satellite communication, satellite positioning, microgravity research, technology transfer, and increasing research infrastructure. And the increasing availability nowadays of satellite data providing a unique asset for the developing country will help in realizing this goal. That means to understand better how the Earth is changing, but also to utilize the insights retrieved from the satellite data to improve the decision making. Well, decision makers take the right decision. Just to let you see, if you see these satellite pictures, are realized because, no, besides the satellite data, it's necessary to process those data. These are realized with the specific satellites. If you read the legend on the bottom, there is the type of satellite and the date with the optical sensors on board. These optical sensors work as our eye. So they take a kind of pictures, let's say, of a part of the planets. And if you see on the left, there is Kenya in 2017, and on the right, there is India in 2019. And you can see the difference, even if, okay, there are 2 years of difference. But even if we take, you know, Kenya now, the difference cannot be so big. What are the main difference between these two, let's say, pictures, okay, these two images? That the light during the night is very concentrated in some small areas of Kenya. Instead, if we look at India, the India country has developed a very huge network of lights during the night. This kind of data, of images, are studied for two reasons. One, to understand how the country during the years
Sir, I think ma'am is disconnected, sir, due to network issues, I guess.
Okay. I think Sylvie madam has got disconnected. For further connectivity, can get connected through madam via LinkedIn. At the outset, I would like to thank Dr. Sylvia Liberto. In spite of her busy schedule, she was able to give a talk on career prospects for engineers. Thank you very much, madam, for a kind cooperation and your kind talk. Thank you very much.
Sir, ma'am is there. She's got connected. There was some network problem, I think.
Shilpa, can you hear me now?
Yes, ma'am.
We can hear.
Yeah, I'm sorry because I don't know what happened. At a certain moment, I was out of the room, so I had, you know, to come in again. I'm sorry about this.
Yeah, kindly start, madam.
But I don't know, you know, which was the last slide that the student they saw the video, and then do you know which someone of the student can tell us which was the last slide? I don't know if they're able to tell us this.
Ma'am, you were discussing about the PhD project that you had done along with your student.
Okay. So I start from that point because, you know, I'm very sorry about this. I don't know what happened. I apologize. I don't know what happened, but you know, I was out of your room or of your virtual room. So sorry about that. I was explaining this project that, you know, just to give you some examples of a lot of things that can be done. First of all, collaborations. Okay, this was also, you know, when I started from my first slide, I said that what is important is also important and also is the part of enjoyable job is to collaborate, to stay with other people in the world. And this is an example that I wanted to tell you about this project that I did, is still in progress with ESA and MIT to study some variables to identify how a specific country is developing. I was telling that this is important because it goes into the direction of the United Nations Sustainable Development Goals. And the space technologies are helping a lot to work in this direction. Nowadays, the availability of satellite data is providing a unique asset for analyzing the countries and to help also the decision makers to get valuable information. I was speaking about this example. I think that you couldn't hear me. This example explaining how we have on the left Kenya in 2017, an image of Kenya taken through a specific satellite, and on the right another image, this is of India, taken in 2019, and you can see how different these images are, because you see different distributions of lights in the night. This is a measure to understand how the country is developing, and you see how much India has developed, because you know the network of lights during the night is distributed practically in over all the country, you know, I think, otherwise I tell you that India is in competition with China to play the role of the first country in the world for development. China and India have overcome the, you know, even USA in the last years, even if there are a lot of problems, because you know we are used, is the same in Italy, to look just to the, you know, to the things that go wrong, but there are a lot of things that are right, and India is developing a lot, as you can see. This is a, you know, is a proof of that, and in the future you are the resources on which India will be able to, you know, to rely on to develop even more. These images, these data, are also used for another things. It's good to see with respect, for instance, to Kenya, how developed is the network of lights, but there are other studies interested to understand the light pollution, because the light pollution is a bad thing in this case. That means that to take on all these lights during the night, a lot of energy is dissipating. So another measure of these lights is to give an idea of the energy which is dissipated. And so the issue is, these lights are really all necessary? How much energy is dissipated? So this is an example just to make you understand how satellite data and satellite studies can help to do a lot of other things. These are some references, and I thank you. And with this, I finish my presentation. Okay, so sorry again for the interruption. I don't know what happened.
Thanks, ma'am. Thank you so much. So it was, as always, ma'am, it was great to see you along with your slide. A lot of information were shared by Sylvia, ma'am, today. Ma'am, anything else we have to do, or should we go through some questions which are posted? I think few questions.
We can go to the questions. I will send to you to Yogesh the presentation, and please share the presentation with my email, all the information with the students.
Sure, ma'am, we will do that.
If you have any questions, please go ahead. Otherwise, they can write emails to me.
Ishwar is asking one question. What skills would you prefer a student to have in his career, his or her career?
Interesting questions. You know, study is important. We are talking about engineering. So we are talking about engineering studies. But as I said before, it's important, you know, to start studying because it's necessary to get, you know, knowledge. But then it's important to develop their own personal qualities. Many of these qualities are inside each of us, you know. Someone is more able to talk, blah, 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 like me. Otherwise, other people are more shy. But general skills required, I think, are to be nice, like my Indian colleagues and friends that I really love because they are wonderful. Sometimes I think that Italian people should take classes from Indian people to become more and more kind and nice. So nice for me is a very important quality. To be able, you know, to interact with the other, even when they are wrong, even if when you want to discuss, is not, you know, useful to shout or to scream, but to be able, you know, to interact in a kind way.
We could see a lot of compliments coming for Sylvia ma'am and how we all were. Like Prakash sir himself is a fan of yours. I can see Yogesh sir following you always. Me, myself, Shilpa ma'am, and who not? Entire East Point College of Engineering has a good fan following for you, ma'am. And the same thing we are seeing today in our feedbacks which are coming from the students. They have thoroughly enjoyed the show and they are really happy and they will get connected to you on LinkedIn. And probably if some questions do come to us, we will pass it to you, ma'am.
Okay, thank you. Thank you. So, bye. Ciao.
Dear students, a lot of questions are there, but keeping the time constraint, which is there, we will connect again and all the questions could be shared with your class teacher. And we will see to that Sylvia ma'am answers all the questions later. That's all from this session. Thanks for joining. Special thanks to Sylvia ma'am who has given this much of time for our students and the college. Thank you once again, ma'am. Namaste, everyone. Have a good day. Take care. Bye-bye.
Thank you. Ciao. Bye.